Comment osez-vous, monsieur? Comment osez-vous? Touchez pas seulement.
C'est délicieux!
Vous me comprenez?
Chirpy laughter.
Here, sir.
Here, sir. Come, sir.
Sorry.
Thank you.
behind.
Such a girl!
Is that? Is that?
Thank you. Thank you. I don't know. Thank you. our teacher before.
Look closer, and you'll see the assassins
clumsily dispersed throughout the crowd, each equipped with a bomb, revolver, and cyanide pill to be taken after the assassination.
Guns, bombs, and cyanide!
The first attempt was by bomb, which Nadejko Chabrinovich threw prematurely.
Oh, I'm so nervous!
Boing, one Mississippi,
bounced off
two
the first car.
Boing, three Mississippi, four Mississippi, boing, all the Mississippis later.
Fell and exploded, injuring an officer. The motorcade continued to City Hall, where the mayor, who did not know of the bombing, greeted the Archduke with great pomp, stressing how happy the people of Sarajevo were that he was.
Oh, welcome, welcome, welcome. We are so happy to see you.
But somebody threw a bomb at me. Giggle.
Sorry. Well, what are we going to do, right? Oh, kids. They see a bomb and they immediately chuck it. Don't worry. Rest assured, it will never happen again.
Nobody in my country picks up a bomb and throws it.
What did you say? How rude!
So the Archduke returned to his car, convinced by the mayor that he was safe. But the car took a wrong turn and stopped right in front of Gabriella Princep, who couldn't believe his luck.
I cannot believe my luck! OMG! WTF, LOL!
And fired two fatal shots. Oh, wait, before you shoot, just a little background on Gabriella. So, he was from a small village in Bosnia, and his family suffered great poverty, as many other farmers did.
Oh, yes, yes, look at my little house, and my parents are so unhappy. And my haircut, what was I thinking?
But he was an idealist that thought by assassinating the Archduke, he would change living conditions in his country.
Oh, that is much better. Look at our soup floor house and the flowers. My parents are so happy, and we have a dog.
No, he fires the two shots, killing both the Archduke and Sophie. He then tries to kill himself, but the crowd stops him and beats the hell out of him. K.O. All hell breaks loose, yada yada yada, and less than 1 month later, war is declared on Sophie. Now, you would expect me to tell you who and what caused it and whether or not this assassination was a good thing, but am I a historian? Do I look like one? You're gonna have to figure it out on your own, but what I do know is that Gavrila Princip has been on trial for the past 100 years.
June 28, 1940. Austrian Archduke Franz Ferdinand was assassinated by a pro-Serbian nationalist. The European time bomb exploded. Austria-Hungary declares war on Serbia, and one generation of war leads to another, until most of Europe plunges into the inferno. Both sides predict victory within a few months.
Revisions I demand in public thought regarding my role in the war once fought. For humanity's progress I certainly ought to tell the tale this sadness has brought. An act of terror, you may call, my fiend for vengeance, but all in all, I see your character is sharp enough to call me out if you sense a bluff. So here we go, enjoy the act, for you to decide what is fact.
State the reason for your shame.
Your Excellence, by this booth, I shall take an oath to tell the tale of truth and desire both. Gavrilo is the first, a man of strong principles. Princip is the last. The reason for my presence, sir, treason. Unfortunately, misunderstood these intentions of mine to free Bosnia from the Austrian line. Treason, unfortunately, sir.
You think yourself brave, I see. Tell me, you're a man of history. Share with us your blasphemy. Also, says here, you're diseased of sorts. Not only of the mental, but also biologically incidental. Tuberculosis.
Your Excellence, my cough is yours. It spreads even through the doors.
Six siblings out of nine we lost. Fever and sneezes dined with us. The reason I don't cough enough is because my actor isn't smart enough. It's not his fault, he's a brave young man. Before the show, over anxiously, he ran to the can. Perhaps I know more than I will ever understand, Your Honor. That is a fact. It would crack the soul of a shellfish. Franz Ferdinand is here no more. Let birds fly forevermore. Upon the clouds, amidst the skies, let their chirps echo into the wild. The prince I shot on Franz Josef Street, after a salami sandwich I bought from Schiller's Meat.
Yes, it was good. Some
Jean
on it as well.
Up the door I stepped to find Franz, as always, looking unkind. So, I came to pull my pistol, drop my salami, to play Mephisto. That is how I came to be, Gavrilo, the hero, yet to be.
Curses with your verses, sir. How lonely your soul is, sir. Wit is not yours to compose. In a prison, you shall decompose. And you killed Sophie. Why so desperate an act?
I panicked. Panic, plain and simple, Your Honor. The more the shots, the merrier. They were not words anyway. None could see the light of day without another. She, the beloved, and he, a humble lover. I had a love like that once. Yes, I remember. One day it was raining, and I held an umbrella over her head. Little did I know that she was rain herself. Yes, it was quick. No regrets, I've made Cupid proud.
Senseless words, gruesome deeds, thoughtless minds, rotten seeds. Away with you, away with you!
Yes, away with us, the workers, the peasants, society's rust. I heard the voices in my head.
Shoot, Gavrilo, have him dead. You'll be a hero in Bosnia's bed. Shoot, Gavrilo, have him dead.
Gavrilo, principal.
Princip, sir.
Principless.
Princip, sir.
Principless.
Principles. Princip, sir.
Away with you. Guards, take away this useless thug. However, your dreams do amuse me so. Go on a rat. Go on, principless. One more verse until you are eternally cursed.
The poor I was supposed to be. How did all this come to be? So dark and filthy, so much blood. My shot started the great big flood. I was young, in love, and hopeless. A stipend paid for a shot to a worthless. A prince who thought himself God. I beg to differ, I will not nod. To this hunger, to this pain, what I suffer is his gain. I will shoot him, I will kill. Cure my Bosnia from this ill. Your honor, if honor seems in the hands of the wealthy, then let it be. Over with me, away with us. The workers, the peasants, society's rust. Jewels and ribbons, a crown and cane, racks, starvation, poverty, and pain. I murdered for the greater cause. My heart was in it without pause. Terrorist, let my name be called. For freedom I shall bring to halt. This rotten hold which belittles us, let I be blamed. It is all my fault. An assassin picked up from the mass, the smell of blood on the grass. It's full I see this hourglass. The prince is here, dead at last. I heard the voices in my head.
Shoot Gavrilo, have him dead. You'll be a hero on Lazia's bed. Shoot Gavrilo, have him dead.
Rocking chair in the house without that old bat noticing. Now, about the talk in the streets. It's the absolute most exciting thing I've ever had. Just think, my Oliver and your Jimmy, brave soldiers, war heroes even, defending our country, fighting in the front lines. How dashing, how chivalrous.
To say the war was glamorized would be an understatement.
I don't know, Minnie. I can never be away from Jimmy for that long. And how would I possibly take care of all the children? There's James Jr., Edward, Minnie, Clarence.
Don't be silly. You know I help you with everything you need.
Yes, but...
But nothing. All of them have to enlist.
Well, you see, we may have found a doctor who would be willing to sign a piece of paper and say that Jimmy has a congenital heart defect.
A genital heart defect?
A congenital heart defect. Either way, he is asking for a lot of money. But if we were to sign it, Jimmy wouldn't have to go to war.
But Fanny, it's his duty to king and country. Jimmy has to go. If anyone were to find out that you were even planning.
Yes.
Heavens, it can't be worth it. It's dangerous. He could go to prison or worse. How are you even going to find the money for it?
But we're still sorting things out. Listen, Minnie, you and Oliver will never get married because you're a...
Because I'm what? Because I'm what, Fanny?
Nothing. Just, you don't have any children. You don't have a family. You couldn't possibly understand. Now I beg of you not to speak a word of it to anyone.
Speak word of what to whom?
Oliver, how ungentlemanly of you to come into my home unannounced.
Oh, does my promise of Fanny, Mrs. Bryce. I'm in nothing untoward by it.
Oh, Oliver, do tell Fanny how excited you are to come to war, my brave hero.
Oh, quite so, love. The crewmen officers were particularly pleased with my height. They said... What ho? Look at that strapping lad.
You'll give the enemy a run for their money.
One fits down, and there goes a Jerry. Just like so. And then I shall reap my rewards.
Oliver, it's your mummy.
Oh, bugger.
Mama!
Minnie, shouldn't you be at home doing the laundry?
Well, I was, but then... We didn't have any soap. So I came over to Mrs. Bryce's to get the soap. And now I'm going with the soap. Mrs. Bryce, Mrs. Walters.
Oh, Lars, we must have a word with her about the soap. Just very irresponsible of her. I'll speak to her. Bye, Mrs. Bryce.
Madam.
Oliver,
Minnie, hold that girl.
I sent her out for soap yesterday. Our girl is frightfully dull.
Oh, that's all bag out of shows!
Oh, right.
Oh, when my dear Oliver left, the only way we could keep in communication was by writing letters to each other. And even though they came frequently, oh, I was desperately wanted to know how it was getting on. Oh, how I missed everything about him.
Dear Minnie, strange how different my life's become.
Good, different.
We just joined up with another battalion. Corky bastards just took down a lazy squad of Germans.
You'll be pleased to know my turn is coming soon, my dear.
Oh, the fellows are brilliant, Minnie. They tease me that I'm not yet married. They think they somehow know the fact that a woman's got a hold on me.
So, not quite
the same without you.
Soldiers like to be frankly told.
Such fun!
Perhaps the front lines were worse than Oliver Letmon. But how was I supposed to know? I wanted her to feel my pain. But I wanted her to feel my joy and my triumph. Is that so wrong?
It's quite a scandal your Jimmy hasn't gone to fight. There's talk in the streets that he's unpatriotic. All of us told me it's just glorious over there. They've had so many victories already, the war is practically over.
Yes, but Minnie, I know where my husband is when I wake up in the morning and when I go to bed at night. I don't have to tell tales to the children or hold my breath when the post comes. I wouldn't trade that piece for anything.
But what will you tell them when they ask where their father was during the war?
I'll tell them that he was at home with us when he belonged.
Oh, I knew I shouldn't have done it. Yes, I know what you're probably thinking. What good would have came out of it?
They'll call him a coward. Jimmy should be fighting with Oliver, with the rest of the brave men in our country. You can't close your eyes and act as if nothing is happening. There's a war going on.
As if nothing is happening? Minnie, open your eyes and look around you. The war reached far beyond the channel. We're all paying for it in one way or another.
Some more than others.
Hello, Mrs. Bryce. I hope I'm not interrupting anything.
No, not at all. Minnie was just about to leave, actually.
Well, I brought you some food.
Oh, no, we're fine, thank you.
No, really, I insist. The rations they gave me are far too much, and you, with all those children and practically nothing, really, you'd be doing me a favor.
Thank you.
Now, do tell me, how is your Jimmy getting along with his heart condition?
I would say it's more of a liver condition.
Maybe.
I just mean to say that Mr. Bryce seems rather weak and delicate compared to someone like your son, Mrs. Walters.
Yes. My son is quite brave, and I hate to be away from my baby almost as much as he hates to be away from his mummy. But we've a war to win. Poor girl. If only you had known how sickly and feeble, weak your Jimmy would be.
Imagine how much better off you'd have been if you'd married my son.
Well, I'd better be on my way. Minnie, I expect you home promptly.
Yes, Mrs. Walters.
Bye, Mrs. Bryce.
Goodbye. Goodbye. Minnie, is it true what they're saying about Jimmy?
Yes. And worse. Look, I miss Oliver just as much as they're going to miss Jimmy, but they're going to win the war and then be heroes. They will have fought for our country's freedom. They'll be part of our history. Isn't any of that important to you?
Yes.
And you can't keep living this lie. People are talking. There are rumors in the street. People are going to find out, and when they do, you will lose Jimmy and your reputation.
All right. I'll speak to him tonight.
You're doing the right thing, Fanny.
So you see, it was me. It was I who had become just as destructive as our enemies. And as the months passed, the letters came less and less. And we can only rely on each other for company. And only rely on each other throughout the hardships. Until...
Peter, go first.
You open yours.
Oh. It's got holes in it.
Well, what does it say?
Dearest Minnie, forgive me for not writing sooner. I hope this letter finds you well. Thank you for the thermos flask you sent me. It is quite a comfort to receive anything from you. What I really wish you could give me is a good blank, long snog, and perhaps a quick blank, bonk. Your picture is hardly enough. Then there are ever so many blanks. What do you suppose they've cut out? Do you think it's really that bad?
Many forgive me for my frankness, since writing the rather crude comments above. I've lived through the most hellish of nights, and I must write it out for fear it will conquer me should I refuse to acknowledge it. So I divulge to you, my love, the agony of my last few days, with hopes you'll not think of me a coward. We are holed up in the trenches somewhere in northeastern France.
we are blank somewhere in France. You would think it's so beautiful here. How lovely.
Any other time, that is, but now it's been raining with German shells each night. And each night, the sun of the wounded rises.
The garden is littered with the dead bodies of German troops, so that's promising. Blank.
But many, far too many of our own British soldiers keep them company. Many have fallen in our front line trenches. Men are buried alive around me. Some we managed to dig out in time, but...
Oh, listen to this. It is amazing how close we've all become. One minute we're strangers, then brothers. More blanks.
You're covered in blood. And your tears are yours. All theirs. And all you taste is the dust and acrid fumes pressing on you. Oh, it is gutting seeing one's friends picked off one after the other. To think I used to find comfort.
I blank find comfort in repeating the words King George sent us off with.
Some nonsense like...
You are leaving home to fight for the safety and honor of my empire. I have implicit confidence in you, my soldiers. Duty is your watchword. And I know your duty will be nobly done. I pray God to bless you, guard you, and bring you back victorious.
What utter crap! Oh, how terribly noble our king sounds, safely stowed in Buckingham, while we bear the brunt of the war for his bloody empire. No, Minnie, there's not a royal address on earth that can make all of this seem worth it. Don't be alarmed, but something else has happened. I've caught the blighty.
Oh, he's been injured, and he's coming home.
Minnie, I hope he's not too serious.
No, it's all right. Nothing we won't be able to cope with. He's coming home! Open yours now!
All right. Dear Mrs. Rice, I regret to inform you.
What is it? Is he injured? Is he coming home?
No. No, he's not injured or coming home. Jimmy's dead. He's never coming home.
Fanny.
No! This is your fault! You did this! This is because of you! You killed Jimmy!
No, Fanny, please!
Minnie, are you going to raise my children? I had a husband who loved me and who took care of me and my children, and now all I have is a piece of paper because of you.
Oh, Fanny, I am so sorry.
What have I done?
I've made a decision for that family that I shouldn't have made.
Does she ever forgive me?
No!
Do I ever forgive myself?
Sarajevo, but really, it's not worth it at all. It's all too much pain, you know? Look, if you really want to kill the Archduke Ferdinand, or maybe for that matter, His Imperial Majesty, the Emperor Franz Josef? Well, you certainly need to have good advice. Am I right? But listen, several heads are better than one. One chap advises you this, and another that, and the deed is crowned with success, our national anthem says. But really, the moment you have to watch out for is when a gentleman like Archduke Ferdinand rides past. Actually, it's like that anarchist, you know, Lucchenier, he stabbed the Empress Elizabeth with a file right in the guts,
yeah?
I know. But, well, the point is that who is going to trust anybody after that? A lot of other people like that let it come to them too, and this coming to them too. Like, it'll be the turn of the Tsar and the Tsarina next. Or maybe for that matter, Emperor Franz Josef, now they've started off with his uncle. But, well, actually, a gentleman was telling me in the pub that all of these emperors, all of them, they would all get done in, one after the other. And all the king's horses and all the king's men wouldn't be able to save them. You know, after that, you know, he had a couple too many drinks, and his landlord had to have him arrested. Yes, I know, but really, I think that, personally, Archduke Ferdinand made a bit of a mistake in Sarajevo when that guy shot him. I mean, he must have been thinking when he saw him, well, well, here's a decent fellow. He must be giving me a cheer. And, well, you know, instead, he was over here and he gave him a bang bang. That's good. Anyway, you know, I'd buy a machine gun, a Browning machine gun, for a job like that. It looks like a toy, you know, and the bullets go by so fast, but in a couple of minutes, I bet you could shoot 20 archdukes of it, never mind if they're thin or if they're fat. Although, well, between you and me, a fat archduke is a better mark than a thin one, am I right? Let me out! Good job! No, actually, I might as well tell you another story while I'm here, about the great silver medal for valor, it's a very interesting
story. Oh, hi, Shane!
Oh, yes,
please. We have another number for you. You'll enjoy it much better for
tomorrow. Oh, of course, I'll be in the witness.
How soon I hear the smile, treated as something taboo. The wise and good, the powers have put, is special through and through. We're classified, fit to be tried, for the law forbids us to. Since we are of different stride, they malign and fine our tie. After all, we're different from the others who find their fun in banality. We don't know what it is to feel that way, 'cause we're brothers and sisters. We love the night so loud and we're so gay. For after on us torment bringing, we near and far are what we are. They'd love to see us swinging, but still we think, were we to swing, you'd soon hear them complain. For sad their plight, in just one night our sun would rise again. After all, we're different from the others who find their fun in banality. We don't know what it is to feel that way, 'cause we're brothers and sisters. We love the night so loud and so different.
Dorothy Lawrence. I'm a journalist and an ordinary English girl. I had a difficult childhood, but I survived. I kept on going. I was about 15 when the war started, and a lot of my schoolmates signed up to become soldiers. I have a very dear place in my heart for these men. They were so brave and honest. They were fighting for our freedom. Well, for your freedom. As the war raged on, it became apparent to me that the rest of the army was not so brave or honest. I had to tell the truth to the world. I had to let them know what was really happening. So I became the first female soldier in the British Army, unbeknownst to them, and I planted mines in France for 10 days. After that 10th day, I had to give myself up due to illness. And since then, I have been trapped. They have trapped me one place to another. Their lies have been my reality. And I cannot escape. This is not what was supposed to happen. It was not supposed to be like this. This is not what was supposed to happen. I did it for our boys. It was always for our boys. I am a journalist. This is not what was supposed to happen.
Here.
I never lied.
Down
I
here.
Never said a lie. You have to know the truth. This is not what was supposed to happen.
Miss Lawrence, sit down. I said, sit down. Now then, Miss Lawrence, once again, why did you sneak into the British Army?
For the soldiers. No one knows. Such scary war. No one knows.
Do not make me ask you this again. Why did you sneak into the British Army?
I told you, I'm a journalist. I wanted to tell the truth. Such brave men, blind, beheaded, mutilated, covered in blisters from mustard gas, drenched in pus, raped.
Up the dosage, she's delirious.
Raped. Raping women, raping children, ravaging innocents. I was raped by my uncle, he was a man of God!
Ms. Lawrence, we've wasted quite enough resources on you already. I demand you tell the truth!
I wanted to tell every young man what would happen when he picked up his fucking flag and sang his pathetic patriotic song. Your troubles in your old kit bag and smile, smile, smile. Don't let the joy and laughter hear the saying. Smile, boys, that's the style. What's the use of worrying? It never was worthwhile. So pack up your troubles in your old kit bag and smile, smile, smile.
Get your sorry ass moving! These portmans are gonna point themselves! Let's go, move it! Stop your fucking coughing, you fucking little maggot! Let's go, move it! Move it! On your knees! On your knees, private!
Sergeant Donahue, I have something that I have to tell you!
Well, stay out, you bloody little fool!
I'm a woman!
Bloody hell. You're not a woman, you're a bloody German spy!
No.
Oh, have you court-martialed?
No, I'm a journalist! I'm a journalist.
to give me the job. I've got more spunk than any of those boys out there. I'm a woman. I've struggled. I know what it takes to be in a situation without hope and to keep on going despite that. I can survive. I will survive, and I will do everything that it takes.
Ms. Lawrence, that just won't work. You see, the army isn't letting any reporters in, whether they're man or woman. Now, there's nothing I can do about that.
Then find a way, fight for a way. Do whatever it takes. We have to tell the story of these brave men. Our government, as well as the German government, as well as every other government, has been throwing our soldiers onto the garbage pits, and nobody knows what happens to them there. And you have to know that that bloody army press bureau isn't telling us the whole truth. You have to know that.
Ms. Lawrence, as I said, there's nothing I can do for you. Now please, just run along to your recipe of the week column. I did quite enjoy the snickerdoodles from last week. Good day, Ms. Lawrence. I said good day. Dodo, come on over here to Uncle Bobo. I'll help you out here. Oh, it's all right. It's okay. Uncle Bobo's here for you now. Have anything to worry about?
But they're gone. They're never coming back. Uncle Bobo, what can I do?
You can stay with me as long as you need. I'll always be here for you. That's the truth.
Thank you.
To the Apollo pub in Vinohradie, and you know, well, he had a little bit of a fight with the butchers from the slaughterhouse, you see. And well, you won't believe this, but they tore off his artificial leg, and then they cracked him right over the head with it. Play it off, come on. That's funny. But you know, when they hit him over the head, you know, the guy who tore it off didn't know it was an artificial leg. So, you know, he just about fainted from the But anyway, as I was saying, they went back to the police station. And then they took the time to put the leg back on. But that wasn't good enough for Mileko, right?
No.
That wasn't good enough for him. Ever since then, he was completely furious about this great silver medal for valor. Great silver piece of shit, he called it. But really what happened after that, it was something like, he was so angry about it, and you honestly won't believe what comes next. This is a complete riot, but, sorry, I can't say this from that. But he took off the medal, and he went over, and he bought it up at the pawn shop. You see, there was this special court of honor for disabled soldiers that got up to him, yeah? So, they seized him in the medal too. They judged him They judged him unfit, so they deprived him of the medal. And his leg as well! Am I right? Plenty of, that's a good one, huh? Yes! Next round's on me. But anyway, now that we're still talking about my regiment and everything, I might as well tell you one more story before I go. Yes. I noticed after a while that a lot of our people in the regiment were dropping like flies. Well, not because they were dying all the time. I mean, that was a problem too, but, well, you know, it's more that they couldn't carry even 30 kilos on their backs as they were marching. They couldn't even stick it out. They were falling over. They were just falling over, and, well, they ought to be giving lectures like our late Lieutenant Buchanek was giving to us. His sort of lectures, in my modest opinion, ought to be given to all troops. He was a bastard, but he had a good heart, you know? He always said things along the lines of, you bastards! You're incapable of appreciating the fact that you're all marching on this globe! All of you, every single one of you, are so ugly and stupid and uneducated, it's enough to make somebody vomit when he looks at you. You should be made to march on the sun. A man who weighs 60 kilos on this miserable piece of shit planet weighs over 1,700 there. And that'll do you all in for sure. And in the regiment, you know, we had this schoolmaster sort, you know, with the glasses, he coughed a lot. But, you know, he was so bold, or maybe even stupid, to break into Lieutenant Buchanek's rant, and he said something a lot like this. Excuse me, sir, a man who weighs 60 kilos on the earth weighs only 14 kilos on the moon. And you see, Lieutenant, sir, we'd be able to march a lot better because our packs only weigh 4 kilos and they'd be much lighter. And then Lieutenant Buchanek, he was a bit angry man, so he immediately just cut him off. He didn't like this at all. So he said, well, well, that's so funny. No, it's not. You're asking for my fist in your jaw, you lousy bastard! But, you know, Mr. Know-It-All, if I hit you on the moon, you go flying up to the Alps and you get smashed up there and die. And if I hit you on the sun, your uniform will be changed to pea soup and that empty head of yours will go flying all the way to Africa. But, you know, well, he just gave this know-it-all school teacher a normal earth smack right in the jaw. It hurt him for a while. He was complaining about it. He was always crying, so pathetic, you know? But, well, poor Lieutenant Buchanek, you know, he really couldn't take the pressure. After a couple of weeks of dealing with this guy, he killed himself. I mean, what can you do? What can you do? I mean, the guy thought the problems. He wrote in his mind.
I worry. My husband is dead and my children are gone. I had no job before he died and after his death. I had no way to support my children, so I sent them to live with my sister. This camp is my home now, but I am never alone. The soldiers are warm and kind, and are most often as generous to me as I am to them. And the best part is that by the time they send me their first love letter, they fall on a battlefield somewhere, quicker than they fell for me. So I'm always in the honeymoon stage.
It all started with a little yellow dust. Well, actually, a lot. The whole factory floor was covered in it. Almost 2 inches of sparkling glory. It's like a warm beach in the Pacific somewhere. It was my first job. A new beginning. It got me out the street and I was helping with war effort. A victory job, they called it. I was just doing my part. Little did I know that part would bring me here. Little did I know that part would mean that my baby was killed by the chemicals. But hey, hey, why the long faces? We all have to do our part, right?
I had to do something. I couldn't just sit there any longer. Daddy warned me not to join the effort. I didn't listen. Do you know what it's like? To sit there day after day and wait. Wait for a letter, wait for a fiance who realistically may never come home. All that waiting can make a girl sick. Sick, I tell you. I'm sick. Robert won't even be able to look at me when this war is over. I can barely look at me.
Hi.
I get a month to recover.
No. I've already paid back your favor.
I can pay you.
No.
I said I'll pay you.
And I'm saying never.
Cause I just set them up.
Contact us. Let us know what you think. Interact.
interact with us on social media. We want to hear what you've seen so far. We want you to tell us what you want to be represented by the Great War. Tell us. Let us know. Let's continue with these auditions, all right?
Next.
You can be introduced?
No.
No?
My dearest Hannah, I am overwhelmed with fear. I was naive when I entered this war and egotistical to believe this was my conquest to win, my battle to fight. The battles are short, but last long hours only feel like years. The anticipation of the first shot of fire from the enemy's guns enough to drive a man insane. As I write this letter to you on this cold night, mess around me smells of a stench so foul I cannot explain, rolling with lice. Tall men cramped in trenches only 3 feet wide, cramped in together like animals. We sleep not knowing when we will be woken, and we sleep ready to fight. I do not understand how these grown men sleep with fully loaded machine guns by next to them. I keep my dagger stowed against my breast throughout the night in the event that we're invaded by the enemy. I am no longer the man you once knew, Hunter. I no longer praise the glory of war. In fact, I condemn it, and all it has shown me. I am left with nothing but misery, a wretched man not worthy of the love of a woman. But we had his God, and I am dead. Marry a woman.
My darling, perhaps sometime, somewhere, I can get a chance to read these letters. I will write to you as I usually do so every day, so you know exactly how the family's been doing. I'm not gonna lie, you know, it's been terribly difficult. Every day the girls ask me when Daddy's coming home, and all I can do is pray that the Lord will keep you safe and sound. God has given me all the happiness in the world for you, and I know that He cannot take that away from us now. You will come home, and we will make a happy home for our wonderful family. We love and we think about you every second of the day, so don't give up on us now, because we haven't given up on you.
For Baco,
for Baco,
for King. Solamente me pregunto por qué. Are you okay, guys?
Oh, you can do it in German.
Scene, hence the accents.
Okay, so your grandparents were Irish or...
No.
Then why'd you try your hand at that?
Well, my babysitter was the granddaughter of an Irish baker. So I really kind of got a connection to that family. I find this amusing. I was 7, she was 14. Just kind of had a big crush in her, would sleep in her bosoms. She'd be running around in her Irish uniform, and a lot of people say that the language of love is Spanish or Italian or French. To me, it's always been Irish.
Cool. And the British wife.
Yeah, that was kind of a complicated concept I was going for there. Basically, I wanted to show that if a British person and an Irish person can fall in love, love can't truly conquer anyone.
So let's just entertain the thought that I take this further. What is going to make your film different than everyone else's?
The accents.
That's what I thought. All right. Thank you very much. We'll be in touch.
Bonjour à tous, je suis ravi d'être parmi vous ce soir et de voir un si large public. Alors, ce soir, je vais vous présenter un projet qui me tient particulièrement à cœur. C'est une comédie musicale qui s'intitule Souvenir. Alors oui, pourquoi Souvenir, me direz-vous, monsieur? Tout simplement parce que mon grand-père, mon arrière-grand-père, je m'énerve, s'est battu durant cette guerre qui a fait terrible. Et a perdu son frère, son ami de toujours, une fois fragile. Il a écrit des chansonnettes à ce sujet, et j'ai donc décidé, dans un élan de fraternité grandiose, de rassembler ses écrits et de vous proposer une œuvre musicale tout à fait bouleversée. Un mélange entre incrédulité, ignominie et même rancœur dialectique. C'est tout à fait. Tout à fait. Mais je pense que ces mots qualifient mon travail. Enfin, sans plus tarder, veuillez vous en faire une idée, monsieur.
Je souviens.
Mac Hartman, c'est qui ce mec? Je connais pas ces mecs, moi. Et nous, nous se battre de rooster.
Bon,
je m'en fous de ce qu'ils pensent, moi. Je veux savoir ce que vous pensez. Si vous pouvez parler français, ça me ferait plaisir, monsieur.
C'était tout à fait bouleversif. Ton chanson, c'est intéressant. Ton voix, originale. Et ton jeu d'acteur, bizarre. Je ne pense pas que ça serait possible. Une comédie musicale française à Hollywood. Ça ne marcherait pas.
La promptitude de votre réponse, monsieur, me désappointe fortement. Ce dédain et cette arrogance que vous prenez là ne vous rendit nullement, croyez-moi. Et puis votre niveau de français, excusez-moi du peu, est tout à fait hésitant. Donne balbutiement à un niveau assez médiocre, monsieur. So let's continue in English, Mr. Hollywood. Les Misérables were shot last year in the United States. It's a musical, isn't it?
Yes, it was a book first, and it was done in English with English actors. It had a good story and a lot of funds. I mean, I thought it was terrible, but... I just don't think that you were... Your work doesn't have any of that. Maybe I would try Quebec. I mean, Quebec speak into the music.
Enough! I won't try Quebec. They don't speak French here, mister. No? And I will let you continue working on Transformers 23 or Sex in France 10. That's great to me, guys. Congrats for that. I'm really impressed, guys. I'm really impressed. For me, I'm gonna go back to France because I have really better projects. Comme on dit dans la langue de Molière, tout ceci est pathétique, monsieur, et consternifiant. Et le niveau de Hollywood est plus bas que celui à lequel je pensais, monsieur. J'ai juste un mot à vous dire, au revoir, messieurs les technos. Arrêtez! Ne m'aide pas! C'est pareil ce monde de... Ce monde de... Oh putain!
Downtown Damascus, he witnessed his girlfriend collapse on the asphalt. She had been shot right in the back of the head. Within seconds, he went crazy. There was nothing that I or anybody else can do to help him. I definitely wasn't about to go back there. I'm a journalist, and worse, a woman. So I did the only thing that I know how to do, which is to ask questions. I wanted to understand what it is about human passion that causes people to do such terrible things to one another, time and time again. I figured maybe if I found, I wanted to understand why people can do such terrible things to one another, but also, I wanted to understand what had led my brother and my entire country to suicide. Maybe if I found the answer to one, the other might believe in life again. And this is the second scene.
Zeitspico, 1916! The French and the British divide the Greater Syria into five nations. As a result of the fall of the Ottoman Empire after the First World War, Israel, Syria, Lebanon, Jordan, Palestine. Can for warfare sound familiar? The Arab nations ruled by monarchs, and once they fall, minorities are given power in puppet democracies, so the majority never gain independence from the French and the British. Sectarian warfare ensues.
And then I heard the news. He had assassinated an Iranian general. He wrote me a few letters he thought I would read if I went back home.
Maria, I hope you never get to read this letter. But if you do, return to where you were at once. There's no place for you here. Go back to where Her Majesty's face on your money keeps you safe. But don't forget what happened to us. We are once happiness pursuers, now rampant and wild. To survive is to kill. No one here deserves the time to learn anything. No child here learns anything except for the petty lessons of war. Soldiers eat each other's fucking hearts here. They say an eye for an eye makes the whole world blind, Mariam. I say let us kill one another until we learn how to see again. First they put me and my nation against the world. Then they put me and the clan against the nation. Then it's me and my family against the clan. Then it's me and my brother against the family. Who does that leave? Me and my brother. They killed her. She wanted to become a journalist, just like you. Had too many questions to ask for her own good. Let us kill one another. Until we learn how to see it.
And that's the scene.
Thank you very much.
Thank you.
I like a lot of the ideas you're bringing forward with this, but you're giving me a lot here. I mean,
for sure.
We're talking World War I, the current conflict in Syria, assassination of a general, your brother's story, that woman being shot. I mean, what's it all leading up to?
It's got everything you need, sir. I mean, the woman you see being shot there, she was shot 4 years ago in Iran for the same cause that thousands are being shot right now in Syria and around the Arab nations, around the Middle East. There's action, there's romance, you know? And I think if you put a little bit of Denzel Washington in there, you might get a few tickets.
I get what you're trying to do. It's just, with the situation as it is right now, it's so hostile and so volatile. I don't think it'd be right to make a movie as it is. I don't want to pour fuel on a fire that's already burning so hot, you know? I don't want to become the next Salman Rushdie.
Fair enough. I mean, the idea really is to kind of not make a documentary about, you know, a particular event that happened during the First World War, which is what, you know, the snippet here talked about. We really wanted to do kind of like a connecting piece so that it wouldn't just be kind of a documentary where it would kind of relate to current events and link them together, to actually have like a purpose. What I don't understand, though, is why it takes at least 10 to 15 years after a conflict has completely subsided until we make a blockbuster hit out of it. I think it's a lot easier for us to look back at the past and judge it than to look at current situations and just accept the fact that we don't do anything about them. As artists, I think it's important to kind of put the pieces together and create a vision and make a difference. Anyways, thank you for your time, sir.
Thank you very much.
Next.
Soldier of all time. Milunka is hungry. She is tired of feeding chickens and talking to cows and plowing the fields. One day, her brother is called to fight. He can't. Maybe he's sick. Maybe he's afraid. Who cares? Milunka is free. That day, Mr. and Mrs. Savage receive a son, Milun. With chopped hair, a sock in her pants, and a gun. Don't fight it. They beg her not to fight it. This isn't your war. Well, what do they know? Years from now, every man that you know will be respected, admired, revered for their efforts, and you will all just be cast aside. Oh, those poor women in World War I just couldn't catch a break. Who are each of you? You're nameless. You're auxiliary. No one knows and no one cares about you, and no one will care after this performance. The Battle of Breganica. Cerna Reka and 23 Bulgarian soldiers held captive later, and Milun is corporal. Or better yet, Milun is feared. We are in battle. Shell parts hit me all over the head, the chest. I can't see, I can't hear, but I can feel. They took off all my clothes.
touched everything, saw everything. Bastards. They then offered me a nurse's position. I can't read, but I was not that stupid. I was not leaving without my gun! Will anyone remember how we were used as sex objects? Breathed arsenic, waited faithfully for the fiancé, but never came home. Mourned our lost loves, nursed murderers back to health? The answer is no. Does the word sacrifice mean anything to you people? You, women, are not the victims of this war. You all fought too. You may not have fought by my side, but where are all your medals?
Well, that was very good. I enjoyed that. I like the idea of like the feminist perspective. I think that's something I could really work with.
Work? What do you mean by work?
I just mean it's a great foundation.
How much effort does it take to stoop to the ground and stick your finger in the manure in which millions of innocent soldiers are currently decayed? Is that your definition of work?
No, I'm just saying we could build on
you it. Capitalist pig! Who do you think you are? Sucking every single last penny out of this project you like to call the Great War movie, in which you are glorifying and glamorizing the deaths of millions of innocents! You fucking capitalist vampire! You know what I have to say to you? Fuck you, okay? Fuck you and fuck this whole thing! I have one message for you, Mr. Big Hollywood Director. Just one. Ladies!